you know, maybe the guy who was closest to Tom of anyone outside his immediate blood relatives. Mike Campbell is on the phone. Mike, are you there?
I'm here, thanks.
Mike, I can't even imagine. How are you holding up?
Well, pretty crummy. Yes. But I'm hanging in there.
Well, you know,
I wanted to thank you guys for, I've been listening to the station the last week. And it's been real good.
Good. Thank you.
Well, one of the things that I know for myself and for Bill is that, you know, being here to keep not just memory alive, but to keep keep it present and to let people know that what may be gone isn't entirely gone is an important obligation. And I'm glad to be able to be here to do it, and also to have Bill as my riding shotgun with me.
Well, Mike,
yeah, Dave, you and Bill have been doing a great job. You've actually helped me get through the week, so I appreciate that.
Well, nothing could mean more to us than to hear that. Mike, you and Tom went through everything together, including the transition from being broke kids in Florida to being wealthy and famous in L.A.
So, well, there was actually a stage where you were broke in L.A. So.
That's right. We were broke a couple of places.
A couple of times, yeah.
Oklahoma, you know.
But you made a long, long journey together, you guys. And how did Tom change, and what in him stayed the same over the course of that 47 years?
Well, that's a good question. In some ways, he didn't change at all. He's always had that pure drive to be great. If anything, as the years went on, I mean, when we were young, he was pretty amped up. You know, he was like ready to kick up his heels at any moment.
Mm-hmm.
As we got into the last 10 years or so, he did tend to mellow in a really nice way. He seemed to let go some of his demons, and he seemed to really be at peace with the art he was making, and maybe a less of a hair trigger.
Yeah, right. He wasn't punching the wall anymore.
Right. As a friend, that was really nice to see him, you know, mellow like a nice wine and get really in a nice groove.
But there was also a character in the songwriting that seemed to, it didn't change, but when you listen to a track like American Dream Plan B, which is one of my favorite late period songs, mm-hmm. you know, I'm going to try till I get it right. He started writing in an almost emotionally topical way, as if, you know, by calling it American Dream Plan B, it was like, man, we can't just accept the norm. You got to keep stepping up. And that seemed to be something that came through in the writing. He may have mellowed a bit, as you say, mm-hmm. like a wine, but his spirit and the message that he wanted to get across hadn't changed at all.
He was committed to the message. The message that rock and roll can save the world. You know, I mean, he was just committed to it up to the last day, you know, that I saw him. He was committed to it, and just he loved what he was doing, and he loved writing songs. And his songs, in my humble opinion, are head and shoulders above most writers that I know, and they're going to last a long time because of his great lyrical craft. You know, he was so good at taking a few words and saying a lot to a lot of people. I remember Jackson Brown once said, you know, Tom pisses me off. I said, why? He said, because he can say in three words what it takes me three pages.
Well, you know, it's funny, that title, Even the Losers, that is the story just in those three words.
And a lot of his songs, I know, it might look easy, but that's really hard to do. And Tom had that in spades. God bless him.
Well, Mike, you, of course, and I think all our listeners know this, but there must be a couple of folks who don't. You were the co-writer of Refugee and Stop Dragging My Heart Around and You Got Lucky and Here Comes My Girl and Running Down a Dream and, you know, so many of the big songs. And I think usually the way you guys worked is you would write and sometimes produce a track and give it to Tom, and he would write a melody and words on it. Were there tracks that came back to you that you said, I never would have thought it was going to go this way? This is totally unexpected.
Yeah, you know, it was such a great gift that he would do that with my music. And it was, you know, because I'd be writing music and imagining, you know, what I would say, what I would sing, and then give it to him without my ideas. And then every time I'd come back and go, oh, my God, I'm so glad I didn't settle for what I was going to do. Because he had a knack for finding the essence of the music that I gave him and just taking it to another level. And that's one of the things I'm going to miss the most. most, I think.
Well, one of the things that he told me that I was really struck by was that we were talking about his songwriting and taking songs into the band, and I won't even use the word approval, but your reaction as a band, yourself, Benmont, Steve, you know, Ron, Scott, the reaction of the band to a song was really important to him, because he knew if it didn't resonate and reverberate for you, it wasn't going anywhere.
Right. Well, we were his sounding board, you know, and they were my sounding board for my music as well. But, you know, I just want to say one thing about that, the band and Tom and the dynamic. I think that he deserves a lot of credit, and to his credit, that he stuck with the band. You know, a lot of egos and other artists get to a point and they go, well, I'm going to go solo. It's all about me. And they go off and do what they're going to do from Elvis on, you know. But Tom had this vision that with the band, it could push him to being the best he could be. And he wanted to be in a band. He didn't want to be a guy with some hired hands. And he saw the value in that. You know, even later on when he could have easily just gone on tour with him by himself with a couple of hired hands and kept all the money himself. But he knew instinctively that there was magic in this band, and that's what he wanted.
Well, he was right. And you know, you got to say, I mean, that's very, I think what you're saying is true, and I think what you're saying is generous. Mm-hmm. But it's also a fact that you don't find guys like you guys every day, and Tom was smart enough to know that.
But I think also Tom saw in his favorite bands, as a young man, as a teenager, the model for what you became. You know, he was obsessed with the Beatles, the Stones, the Zombies, and that particularly that generation of 60s British Invasion rock and garage band, where it was, you know, it was a gang of guys with a common bond and a common drive. And the thing that resonated for me so much when I was doing the interviews for this story was when Steve Ferroni said, yes, the billing was Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, but the reality of it was Tom Petty in the Heartbreakers.
Yeah, that's one way to look at it. But, you know, a band, I don't know. I don't want to get too philosophical, but our band was very fortunate that we all met each other when we did. And I'm really proud of the way we play. It's a great band. Nobody else can sound like us. And you can't plan that, you know. And it just happened for us. It's like my friend Randall Marsh was saying, you know, you and Tom, you guys, you know, got on a comet and just rode it, you know. And we kind of did. We just caught a wave of energy being together and finding each other and having a common dream and the ability to do it and then have it explode beyond our wildest dreams. We were like the most happy, lucky guys in the world to, you know, accomplish what we did. And also to meet all our heroes and have them like us over the years. It's like a dream come true. I mean, it's almost hard to talk about it because, you know, I don't know. It's the American dream, like you said.
I interviewed Tom last winter and for Sirius, and I said, how long did it take you to get used to the fact that it actually happened? And he said, I'm still working on it. I'm still trying to figure it out.
Well, it was funny. I was talking with a friend of mine in England who saw Tom and the Heartbreakers, their first London show at the Hammersmith Odeon. And he said that he said it blew his mind. He was a writer for Melody Maker in Britain. And he said that you guys actually did a series of shows there over, you know, a fairly short period. And he said the thing that was astounding was the first time the balcony was closed and the floor was sort of half empty. By the third show, the place was totally sold out. It was as if, you know, the word of mouth spread so quickly that, you know, everybody knew this was the place to be.
Well, you make a good point, too. You know, and it's probably true of any journey like this where you have a dream and you work hard, you put your nose down, and it all starts happening for you, and you're so in it, you don't really have time to stick your head up and go, oh, my God, look what's happening. You're just doing it, you know, and you keep going, more gigs, more records, and just you're moving forward all the time. And then something like this happens this week, and it's like, that's what I was enjoying about your station, is I was actually able to stick my head up and look back and go, oh, my God.
Look at what we did.
And you guys play the, like these rare live tracks and stuff, and when I hear that stuff, it blows my mind. I was like, I'm hearing some other, who are these guys? They're amazing.
Yeah, they're really good. Who are they called?
You know, a number of people have said to me that if Tom had known that this was going to be his last year, he couldn't have done it better. The Songwriters Hall of Fame, the Grammy tribute, the 40th anniversary tour.
The Music Cares Night.
Music Cares Night.
Well, obviously he didn't know, but it's a perfect storm of a great bow on the end of a story. And I got to tell you, I just want everybody that's listening to know this. I was on stage, of course, at every gig. I was on stage with him at the last three shows of the Hollywood Bowl. After this long, grueling tour, and I knew he had some issues with his hip. He never whined about his ailments. He was a tough soldier. But I want everybody to know, when I went on stage that last night, and he walked out to the crowd, put his hands up, and started his whole, I feel a mojo building in here, you know, like he would do a lot of nights. And I looked in his eyes, and that guy was so happy. It's like, I just looked at the God, man, he's in such a blissful place. He's so proud of the band. He's so proud of the audience. He's so proud of himself that we're all here and it's all happening. And he's the top of his game. And I just want everybody to know that. He really led it those last several months. He was just, he wouldn't have. And Tony was telling me the other day, he said, Tom told him before the tour, you know, I'm going to do this tour. I've got a few issues, but, you know, I'll do it if I have to sit in a chair.
Yeah.
You know, and he didn't. But God, he was really happy.
He made it to the top of the mountain.
He did. And he went out before he stumbled on the other side.
Yeah, well, may be the perfect coda for Tom. It's just pretty tough on everybody who's left behind, you know.
Right. It's just way too early, way too soon. We had so many plans, you know, we talked about that we were going to do next year and all these things. We had no idea. He had no idea this was going to happen. And now we're just, like you said, we're left with the hole that cannot be filled. You know, I have a friend that's gone. I'll never play those songs with him again. I'll never write a song with him again. And I'm trying to process that, and all the fans, I'm sure, are trying to process it. But I tell you what, and listening to your station brought this back to me last week or so. We have some fucking good songs, and we were a great band.
Great band.
And that stuff is going to last a long time. You know, I don't know, 300 years from now, 400 years from now, some kid somewhere will hear Refugee or Beat Ballin' and Running Down a Dream. And they'll feel something, you know, they'll feel hope or redemption or love or something. And that fucking spark will just keep on going. That comet will keep flying on, you know, way past X.
Mike, there's no question about it. When all the rest of us are forgotten, this music is going to keep going. Even when people don't know who made the music, you know, like classical music.
Of course.
People are going to know the melodies. They're going to know the words. It's going to become folk music. Yeah. It's going to become part of the
intentional outcome of our journey was that, and without sounding too egotistical, we were able to capture some immortality, and it will go on.
That's not that's not ego. That's a fact. You created a great American songbook.
Well, thank you. It's not like that was our goal, but it is an outcome of this. These songs are so good that I know they'll last long past us, all of us, and that's beautiful.
Mike Campbell, I can't thank you enough. I know how hard it is for you to get on the phone and you know, talk to the nation about Tom at this time. But it's a blessing to have you. And listen, figure out how you're going to keep the Mike Campbell music coming, because we don't want to get cut off from that.
I'll request.
Thank you very much. I don't know what I'm going to do yet, but I'm going to do something because I have to.
Because you have to.
But one thing I would just share this is great. The grief that we're all going through, both you guys, and I feel your sincere grief, and I feel the fans. We're all, like, shocked and in this dark place. But what I am doing is I've learned that when you're in a spot like this, the best healing and the best way to get through it is to be of service to other people that you love. Reach out to other people that are struggling and help them, and that, in turn, helps you get through it. So that's my two cents.
That's a pretty smart two cents. Mike Campbell from the Heartbreakers.
Thank you very much.
God bless you.
Much.
Thank you.
Okay, guys, keep it going. It's up to you now.
We're on it for you.
Say hi to everybody for us. That was Mike Campbell from the Heartbreakers. Very courageous of him to get on the phone, because I know he's pretty broken up.